Recording in progress.
Okay, there we go. All right, we are up and running. Okay, I'm calling us to order at 6:36. If everyone would please rise for the pledge.
I'd like to lead us to the flag. And to the Republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Next item is public comment. If you are speaking, please put your name and address on the list on the podium. And I don't know if anyone has signed up already.
Thank you, buddy. So before I get started, I would like to request that my written public comment be added to the BOS meeting minutes, along with the sources we're going to be citing.
You have 3 minutes, so.
If I get cut off, we have really good copies with me that can be passed around. If people want to give us, if I can't finish. My name is Caroline Leary. I live at 21 Grand Road. And while I serve on the Bethany Board of Education, I am speaking tonight as a concerned Bethany resident and mother of three. So I started doing some research how Connecticut, towns in Connecticut, responds to town employees who commit heinous crimes, specifically possession of child pornography and are accused of child molestation. And there seem to be two actions that officials take that seem to be pretty standard procedure. One is when they find out when there's an investigation, the employee is immediately placed under restricted leave, but prohibited from returning to the workplace upon learning of the investigation. And then number two, they inform the public as soon as notification is received that there's been an arrest. Paula Francisco did neither of these things. I have with me a few articles that I highlighted different sections on, but I'll only speak of the first one because it's the most recent. The middle of August 16th, there was a case in North Branford where a woman was charged with possession of child pornography in Guilford. The town manager said that when he learned of the investigation, the police approached him and said that he could not go public because they didn't want to compromise the investigation. So while he did not go public at that time, he did place the town employee on administrative leave and prohibited them from returning. So on July 23rd, during a big town meeting, attorney Vincent Marino stated he first learned of the mass random matter a couple of months ago. That would mean that attorney Marino learned of the mass random case in May of 2024 or thereabouts. In fact, mass random was first arrested on May 24th. Bethany Town Constable Dave Marion allegedly approached Paula Francesco at the spring play event at UCS on May 24, 2024. And he notified her, allegedly, that Ms. Randall was being arrested at that very moment. I could stop.
That's been
a little bit faster. Thank you.
Yeah, mics is picking up. Could be that mic.
In that act of the rest of 2024, that in town council, the area can allegedly approach Paul Francisco at the spring cleaning event held at the Bethany Community School on May 24th and notified her that Pastor Pinello was being arrested at that very moment. Even though the hearing stated at the town meeting that it's not my investigation, it seemed to me that a simple act of allegedly informing Paul that there was an arrest was considered a notification of actionable information. If it is true that Paul Francisco knew of the first arrest, one, why didn't she immediately notify the town on May 24, 2024? At that point, it was public information, although the news did not reach our small community until the Associated Press picked up the story on June 26. We, the Bethany residents, were shocked and horrified to learn the allegations against Pastor Giles and the subsequent second arrest for the first time when it was broadcast in the evening news. And two, also in an NBC News negative article, when the Frankfurt town manager stated that as soon as he was aware, the library employees have been arrested. Action was taken to inform of him. He further assured that while he was not the public and being under the investigation, he placed the employee on administrative leave and were prohibited from returning to their position. Here in Bethany, the first selection called the Frankfurt stated in two different letters posted to the town Facebook page on June 27th, 2024, and June 28th, 2024, as well as at the special town meeting on July 23rd, 2024, that upon learning of DPS possible involvement, Master Angelo was both removed from the children's environment. Paula herself confirmed that the same special town meeting that Master Angelo will continue working at the town hall for the clerical duties and cleaning up for the parks and rec department, which is located inside the town. While Paula stated the clerical duties and cleaning up the closet occurred when no children were present, cannot be overlooked and still have full access to the town hall. We don't see how Paula claimed that he had no contact with any children to be substantiated, as there were no cameras inside town hall. So unless Paula herself was with him at all times, personally supervising him, she had not done. We don't see how Paula can state that the town can confirm that this individual has not any contact with children under our care since December 2022. Remember, he still has no contact. Paula allegedly refused to allow cameras to be installed. It has also been stated that cameras have not been installed because of some kind of delay in receiving grant money. What is the truth? Why was the master delegate on administrative leave and prohibited from returning to town hall? Note that Superintendent Taper stated in a UCS community letter on June 27th at 10:30 in the morning that following notice of the possible DPS report related to Master Angelo, he was immediately placed on the team of DPS and has not worked for volunteers at school since December 23rd and will not be returning in any capacity. Attorney Benjamin Lee was supposed to be our town attorney and represent the town's West Engine. That includes taking every measure necessary to protect our children from predators. What will attorney Romina's obligation to advise the college to take immediate action by notifying the
state that that's 3 minutes?
Just that last paragraph there. To be able to get it in. Aaron Thursby, 19 Field Road. Further, the special town meeting on July 23rd, 2024, when questioned about the Department of Children and Families involvement, both Attorney Marino and Captain Paula Francisco stated that they, quote, do not know the nature of the complaint. It's on who afford video recording. So it sounds like this is the reason they are saying the town was never notified. I would like to, I am speaking before, which having not met this before, we would like to refer everyone to DCF policy, chapter 22-3, operational definition of child abuse and neglect. If DCF is responding to a complaint, it involves some kind of abuse or neglect. Everything listed in the purview of this policy, which includes sexual abuse, are things that can trigger a DCF investigation. You would have to be living under a rock and extremely out of touch not to realize that the DCF is involved. It's pretty horrible. In our opinion, Paula Pocorsetto did not need to know the quote nature of the complaint in order to take immediate action and protect our children by placing Matt Pangello on administrative leave, revoking his access to town hall, and prohibiting him from returning. Paula can contact the PCF at any time to ask for a status update. They would not permit to give her information about the investigation, but as he was employed by the town, PCF could confirm whether there was an open investigation or not. It is patently obvious to me that Paula did not do everything in her power to protect our children. That is not only unacceptable, but it is also an infraction. Last of our time, I just want to also point out that I know this has been mentioned by Paula and the town attorney that the mother's previous administration is the cause of this. I just want to mention that they're looking strangely, but we've heard it. But for the record, they're looking shocked by that piece of information. So maybe that's just rumors I've heard. But what I will say is, I wasn't in the town while my mom was running the town primarily. She could have done a terrible job, but I do know that she was not a liar and she was not misleading people in any way. So, and Paula and this administration has been in office long enough to be able to take responsibility for the results of all of this. Thank you.
Is there anyone else?
Someone is there to ask us.
Oh, I'm sorry. Oh, yes, Jamie. Thank you for catching me. You have to unmute yourself.
Good, thank you. Can you hear me okay? Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Thank you. Jamie Sterling, 20 Miller Road. Good evening, and thank you all for serving and for having public comment. I was interviewed today by the Hartford Courant about the signs in Bethany. Since you can't control how a reporter might spin your words, I would like to share what I told the reporter. I support all residents' right to express their opinions, unless they advocate hate or violence, and yard signs are a small town tradition. I said I personally think that Selectman Kofrancesco should resign because, as tonight's agenda makes clear, we are spending a lot of money to correct mistakes. Common sense tells us that new leadership will more effectively and probably less costly deal with this mess. And I told him I would prefer to see signs that say accountability matters. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay. Don't forget, please.
Was that the last one? I want to make a small question as to is just a member of the public. I'm Gina Texera, otherwise known as Selectman 3.
Gina, sign in after speaking as a resident.
I just want to say briefly that, I was on the investigation when it was reported in June, and I was a probation officer involved in the summer program, and it was chilling to think that I could be so involved in the town and not know if this anything at all about this. And so I waited a couple of days, and then I sent an email to Paula that she, I think, has since forgot about, but. I think, even though I was angry with her at that time, my first instinct was to try to help her. Believe it or not, I feel bad for her that she, rightfully so, we can't, but I did on a human level feel bad for her, and I tried to help her. And the first thing I did was to give her advice, and I told her that she should apologize. And that was, she was kind enough to give me heads. Off that first time that we had the media and cameras here. And she told me what she was going to say, and I was really horrified I said, you're not, you have to apologize, right? That's the first step of moving on. I don't know if, anyway, since then I've learned that trying to give all advice doesn't really work. You shouldn't listen. And I think that advice, you know, even though we ran at the same time, it was really on a human level, just trying to give her good advice. She rejected that advice and said, made a lot of excuses that night in her statement. And one of the things that I want to just say is that it's irritating to have someone refuse to take responsibility when it's so easy to do. People do it all the time. Just refuses to take responsibility. And, you know, finally, she has made a statement in Bolton. I think she maybe caved to some pressure that people mentioned that there hadn't been a statement. And I just want to point out something at the top of the second column where she said, and she's referring to December 2022, which she said, at that point, the town was legally and ethically bound not to comment on an open investigation. And I just want to say to you, like, we're all being gaslighted, okay? Because this is not about talking about an investigation. And I think a month ago she apologized. What was the apology for? It just totally takes it back. First, that before the finance meeting, when the town attorney said she did everything right and Paul would not correct him. And then we have this bulletin that says she, again, refusing to take responsibility and claiming that she was under a legal obligation to stay silent. And I'll say to you, that's bullshit. Okay? Because everyone knows, everyone has heard that you can say, not comment on investigations, you know nothing about her. She could have said, we have heard of the investigation, these are the actions we took, your child is safe. That she could have said, without a doubt. Stop making excuses for her.
I just want to point out that not everybody has received that in the bulletin. I have not received it. I have not other people haven't received it. I don't know what happened. All of a sudden, in the past 2 months, you know, I think I've gotten one, and it's basically the other end of the month. So now I was happy about that.
The printer is the one that does the mailing. Well, I'm telling you a fact. The printer mails the bulletin. That's an issue with the post office.
Anyone else? Public comment is now closed.
Okay, next item on the agenda is approval of minutes. We have a series of minutes. July 31 special meeting. May I have a motion to accept?
This is the July 31st?
Yes.
Okay, no, I have some correct.
Well, we need to second and then discuss.
Okay. Sure. Okay. So second for discussion?
Yes. Okay. What page?
First of all, I think my name is spelled two or three different ways, and so I ask that the name be corrected.
Okay.
So that's the first thing. I mean, I could point it out if you want, but I think if someone does,
we'll go through
and it's correct at the top, the first page. That's correct.
Okay, we'll go through and double check.
Okay,
throughout the document.
In the second paragraph, Selectman Texera requested to make a statement prior to getting into the agenda. The second sentence, I just want to ask for clarity, which is what I said at the meeting. Selectman Texera proposed that item number 3, by labeling it just legal, was insufficient under the rules of freedom of information.
That's what you want to add?
Yes.
Okay.
And I think this is a typo in the bigger paragraph, second line. It says,
First Selectman Co-Francesco has inserted herself into some situations and the is an issue.
With
that, that probably, yeah, that.
And the.
Right,
and
that.
Oh, and that.
Maybe change that to that, yeah.
Yeah, okay, got it.
And then my name is spelled wrong a couple of times. If you go down to.
We'll double check the entire document for the spelling.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, so you don't have to pick out each one, but go through the entire thing and make sure it's correct.
Okay, then if you look at the third paragraph on the bottom, Selectman Texera stated while in executive session, this is confusing to me when I read it. It sounds like the town attorney is talking to people in executive session. I said that while we were in executive session, we came to inform people, and that was explained at the time. So I don't know if.
You might want to say, town attorney left the meeting to advise the public, right? Because that's never, that's right, what
that's
I did,
what
right?
Did, yes.
So which is this, right? I stated that while on the executive session. Yeah, so. I'm going to say, right? So you might even just say, at that paragraph, Attorney Marino left the meeting to inform the public.
Yes.
Well, what do you mean?
Well, you said something about her not being recused during the break, and that's how I think about it.
Yeah, but that wouldn't have been part of this meeting.
Well.
Right. What I said.
But this, this is what Gina said at a. Previous meeting about referring to a meeting even before that.
So I'm talking about how I learned that Paula was recused.
Okay.
Because someone in the audience.
All right. So the Secretary stated that Attorney Arena informed.
Left the meeting to inform the
public. Well, Attorney Arena stated to the public. Or.
In the gym, maybe.
I understand that.
You see what I'm saying? Because the way it's written is really confusing, but I don't want to.
You know how that attorney referred to a statement made by Attorney Marino concerning the first selectman.
Right, right. Maybe take out executive session. Right. Just confusing okay. It all. Yeah. That works a lot better.
Yeah. Like, can you?
Yeah. So the.
Selectman
Sarah referred to a statement made by Attorney Marino to the public.
All right, hold on a second. Referred to a statement made to the public.
By Attorney Marino. Concerning Selectman Chesko's recusal?
That she was not recused. That was the information that was new to me.
I guess it's kind of an issue. Was not recused from what?
I thought she was fully recused. That's when I found out she wasn't. Right. So that's based on what I was just
saying. So she was not recused.
Right.
Period.
Right.
The second sentence goes?
I think the second one's okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So I think there's more. Are we okay?
Well, I want to make sure we have that sentence correct.
Okay.
So let me check Sarah. Referred to the statement made by attorney, made to the public by Attorney Marino, and then does it pick up?
By Attorney Marino, that first selectman Co-Francesco was not recused.
Okay, so that just
right, so
which again, that right.
Right.
Okay,
all right. So the rest of the page is okay.
Okay.
Okay. The second page, the selectman Texera paragraph.
Mm-hmm.
This, I'm not going to force everyone to write the minutes the way I actually made the statement because I think it would take too long to kind of make it accurate.
Mm-hmm.
But there are some real inaccuracies in here. So, for example, this says Saturday, July 28th. I don't think Saturday was July 28th. I just want to make sure at least that part of it is okay. Saturday was the 27th. So, Texera wanted to add to the minutes that I basically wanted people to know that this paragraph is talking about, I wanted to outline my attempts in correcting the agenda that said executive session legal or something like that. And I had been trying to correct the agenda and no one was getting back to me. So my first email was Thursday, July 25th. That first line is correct. And did not respond. And then the third line, it says
should be the 27th.
The 27th.
Okay.
But there's something. It's a, so I wanted to say to avoid delay, did not receive a response until Saturday, July 27th from the town attorney. But this isn't what I said because I did not receive a full response that day. I received a partial response. And then, so I think if you just say that she received a partial response on the 27th.
Do you want to like type up what you think this should?
I mean, I could do that if you think it would be easier. Because I have, you know, I still have my notes with me because I was really wanting to just document the five or six attempts I had made.
All right, why don't we table it so we can get the clarification on that. And in the meantime, we can get your name corrected.
All right, so who can I send my draft to?
Maybe if somebody could send Gina
Jen.
But if you send it in like Word, then you could.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Then I'll do a track change.
Yeah.
And then you could see, okay, see so if you guys can see if you like them.
All right, we'll send it to you.
Okay.
We'll send it to you.
Yeah. Perfect.
Jen did these minutes, so we'll have her send them. One of us will send them to you.
I think after that, there's not a whole lot more. That I think that's the main thing. So,
all right. So why don't we have we've already got a motion to discuss, but why don't we amend that motion to table if you're okay with that.
Motion to postpone until second.
Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
All right, okay, so we've tabled this until October. Okay. All right. Next minute are the regular meeting minutes of August 6th. Motion to approve.
Wait, what's the date?
The August 6th, the second set of minutes on the agenda.
I have something here too, but let me see if it's. There's. If you look at the very bottom of the first page, I made a motion to have part of the discussion with the labor attorney in public session. I made a motion. Bob seconded the motion, and you, Paula, you said no. You disagreed. So it was not a unanimous approval on that.
I don't recall disagreeing.
You don't.
I mean, I don't know why I wouldn't. Why I would disagree to ask the questions.
I don't either. No, you didn't. You didn't disagree with the executive session. You disagreed with having a conversation within an open session.
But you wanted just general questions. Why would I?
Are you saying you agreed? Because my recollection, I looked over and you were shaking your head and you said no. Bob, do you remember?
I don't remember which way the vote was.
Okay.
I took the minutes. Now, Gina could be correct. There could have been two separate motions regarding amending the agenda. And I may have missed it and combined it into one. I can look back at my notes, but Gina could be correct. I don't have them with me at the table.
Should we table this one as well?
At least I can get clarification on them.
Is there anything? I'm just curious if there's anything else in this one.
I didn't have any other remarks. I don't think I said in that.
I think that.
Okay. Right. So, motion to table.
Second.
Okay. We'll just table these to October as well. We have the August 15th special meeting. That was those. Done by Nick.
Move approval.
Can I have a second?
Yes, I second that.
Corrections? No.
No. I like the fact that Nick got on one page. It's a good summary.
Okay. Well, it was kind of a.
He didn't want to do a transcript. Aye.
Okay, we have approved the August 15th minutes of that. We do have one tax refund, which was left for me. It is for a Joseph and Cynthia Nadeau. It's an excess payment, and it's $11.20. So can I get a motion to approve the tax refund?
So moved.
A second?
Second.
Okay, any comments or questions? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye, okay. We have no cemetery deeds for approval for this month. Russell Road.
Yes, so just to update the selectmen on this. So one of the owners of the fee interest filed for Chapter 13 bankruptcy. And so the issue with closing Russell Road has been on the seller's side, and that's clear and title. When they subdivided this lot out, they never actually got releases from the encumbrances like the mortgages and whatnot. So it appears, and I've spoken to Attorney Alito and waiting for him to get back to me on where things stand on their side. But based on my review of Chapter 13 bankruptcy, it appears as part of the debtor's plan or the seller's plan is to, they've assumed the contract. So in bankruptcy, within 60 days, you have to assume or reject the contract. They assume the contract and they intend to proceed with the contract, but they're, I think, going to be utilizing the bankruptcy court to try to get rid of these leads because they probably are having issues with the lenders. But that's my best guess, because that's why you would use the bankruptcy to strip the liens from the property. But I'll keep you informed on that. But I'm waiting to hear back from the attorney.
Okay. And the proposed solar farm, we are just waiting to hear if it's closed, right?
Exactly.
Okay.
Yeah, so that's, the shot is not that much.
Yeah. Okay. Simpson property?
I am working with Attorney Francois on advancing this matter. And I will respond to an email today. I've been in touch with Allison Clark from Deep, and we are hoping to have this matter closed this calendar year.
And Paul, can you just remind everybody what the Simpson property issue is and why it's on the agenda?
Well, it was started prior to me. It was with two grants, Audubon and Deep. And so we saw that it was still waiting, you know, to be closed. And then we found there was another issue with the Carrington property preserve that had to have some title cleared. So now it's basically went to the attorney general. Well, Carrington has closed, that is clear. The Simpson piece has gone to the attorney general. I'm just waiting to hear back.
So where it stands right now is, I believe the grant approval, I believe, or the grant agreement, I believe, is being referred to the Attorney General's office for review and consent. Once that is back, then that will be given to the town for execution. And then once it's executed, I'm told it takes about 4 weeks to find it. So I'm told it's about 2 to 3 weeks to come back from the Attorney General's office.
And what's the amount of the funding?
Both grants cover 100% of the acquisition. I believe one about two, I'm going to say 250 and 150 for round numbers, but I can give you the specific numbers.
No, I think I have it somewhere. Thank you. That's good.
So that's where we sort of stand with that. And hopefully, like you said, before the calendar year is out, we finally see some closure.
Right.
Okay. Independent investigator status update. I did see the posting in the newspaper today. I have to cut it out and gave it to Jen so she has it in her records.
And all the letters, the cover letters went out to the list that we had discussed at your last meeting, with the exception of the three that's something written to give me, and it was just an oversight on my part that would go out.
Okay. And that there was some issue with what went up on the website for attachment A, which is all the arrest warrants. For some reason, with forwarding, it's one of the email servers turned it into like a link with the link. So what's up? Jen put up what she received, which is only like one page. So I think I sent her what you originally sent me.
You did
the whole thing.
Then I didn't have to do it. Thank you.
But I'm waiting to hear from Jen tomorrow if she If it got blocked by the town server, then...
I'm just asking if I can get the operative documents.
And you don't have it either.
Well, Jen had directed me to the town's website for purposes of the operative documents. So what I used was what was on the town's website. So if I could have the operative documents sent to me, just make it... I appreciate it.
I'm gonna send it to you right now.
Email problems. All right, that's the update. And then the responses are due, I think, on the 23rd of September. And you're scheduled to meet the next...
No, you posted a special board of selectmen meeting for the opening. Yes, I just want to make sure. At 6:30?
Yeah.
The letters of referral, is that what it is? The letters of referral?
Interested.
The letters of interest, okay. All righty. Next item, the before and after school program did open. First day of school, we were up and running. Want to say we had approximately a dozen or so kids in the morning program. And approximately 30 to higher, approximately 40 kids for the after school program. You know, we're looking carefully at the ratio of counselors to students. I did talk to Kay to see what was happening with the school. She said none of her staff appeared to be interested in running the program. She had one person who apparently was interested in the before school, but didn't want to do every morning. So I guess at this point, she will have to be looking to advertise outside of staff to see if she can get any interest of people to do it.
So is it your understanding that she's still moving forward?
I guess she's still, you know, going to do whatever she needs to do to see if she can get a program going. But right now there was no interest within term of staff. So
for morning and for the
afternoon? Right. Yeah. Well, I think morning they have a little more flexibility because their contracts, they start school a little bit later. So, but they also have contractual obligations with time that they have to be there. With the commission, if you saw the, some people said they didn't get the bulletin, but the notice was posted again for boards and commission vacancies. I wanted to make sure everybody had an opportunity to see it because August is a lot of vacations and people are away. So I wanted to make sure that people had a chance. I'm figuring maybe what we can do is hold a special Board of Selectmen meeting, if you guys are amiable to that. We'll give it about a week or so to see if we get any responses with the second posting. I'm looking at maybe the 19th.
What is this for? Are we still?
Park and Rec.
Are we still on number 9?
No, I moved to 10. I'm sorry. We are on number 10. But just giving a week or so that people have ample time to see it and respond if there's any additional interest. And then we can have a meeting just geared toward that.
I just have real reservations with moving ahead on that when we're spending all of these resources. We're doing what the town asks us to do. We're going to have an investigation. We're spending a lot of money on legal advice, and we want to do things right.
Mm-hmm.
And so I just think it's probably premature to move ahead in this way with Park and Rec because we're going to get recommendations from investigation. And I think, you know, putting energy into something that I just feel like we're working against our own agenda with what the town is asked to do. And I think it's premature.
Okay. What I'm also thinking is the town code review committee does meet in October, and potentially having them look at the code, because right now the code reads up to 7. So you could have one or two people on the commission the way it reads. I'm thinking that maybe we should be looking at potentially how some of the other boards are put together, say like the planning and zoning, where they have 5 regulars and 2 alternates, so that you can always have a meeting. You know, with 5 people, your quorum is 3. But if you happen to have 3 people out, but if you have alternates, you can still have a meeting. You rotate those people in just like we do with the P&Z. Those people are usually at the meetings. And then if somebody's a no-show, they sort of rotate around to be able to have a quorum. So you can still have a meeting. So that, you know, might be something that the review committee could potentially be looking at to revise the code, and also looking at the terms. Is a two-year term sufficient? Should it be a little bit longer? Right now, with the commission, they all come in the same time. They run the same 2 years. So should it be staggered terms so that you're not losing everybody all at the same time? So these are just some things to potentially have the town code review committee looking at.
I think we should appoint the Park and Rec Commission members. This is for issues going forward, not what happened a year, mm-hmm. 2 years ago. Other programs, not necessarily just the before school, after school. I don't think there's any reason. I did agree with the, you know, some people said don't just throw some names out there, ask everyone, right, and then we'll have to go through the responses. But I think we should do it sooner rather than later.
We could certainly have a meeting and discuss it a little more and then decide there, and then like
what, at least we should send us all the
right once see if we get any more responses,
not resumes, but whatever expressions of interest, and we'll look at but yeah, I don't
we tentatively want to hold a date so that we have it if we I was just looking
would,
at all
would,
the other
I
meetings.
Would do a special meeting instead of waiting until early October.
Well, no, that's what I'm saying. Potentially holding a date.
And just do that, to just be Park and Rec.
Right, here, just to that, yeah. I was just looking at all the other dates and with other meetings and things going on. Would everybody be available on September 19th?
I just want to reiterate that. I'll look at my calendar in a minute, but I just want to reiterate that I think it's contrary to the goal of doing this right. You know, the town's, you know, we agreed to do an investigation, and part of that investigation involves recommendations, and part of that process involves what we will do moving forward. And I feel that it's really a disservice to what we're trying to do here to say, let's get this other entity together and possibly do things that will contradict what comes out in the investigation. But I just want to say, I think it's unfortunate that that's where that people seem to want to move. And I just want to say that I object really wholeheartedly on that. I think that we put a lot of energy into this. I certainly have, and a lot of other people have, and I think we should do it right. And I don't think that's the way forward.
I don't see having people who are willing to work on Park and Rec, meaning that they won't listen to any recommendations that come out of an investigation or improvements.
Well, it's possible they could meet and implement whatever the changes they want. I think it complicates everything. I think we are in a crisis, and I think we should stop and move forward with when we have certainty about what to do. I mean, Paula's known since December 2022. She could have convened the commission then. Why didn't she? I mean, I just think that at this point, where it's my understanding that there were no lifeguards, you know, at the lake because people didn't have the proper credentials or whatever, I could be wrong about that, but I just think that we should stop and do things right and not take steps until we know what it is that we're doing. And I do think that doing it this way, that there could be possible contradictions and just making things more complicated than they need to be. And I think that when something like this occurs, we should proceed with caution, and we should proceed when we have answers that the town wants. And so I just want to say I object to this whole plan. I don't see how it could be productive.
Well, I think it might be helpful just with oversight of with a commission overseeing monthly statements as to how the budget is being spent. And you know, there's space.
When I first got on this board, I was told that Park and Rec was the most productive program, the most profitable. That's a quote program that this town has. And Paula told me that. And I sat in through Zoom on a board of finance meeting a couple of weeks ago and found out that that was not true. And so you had
you've had almost 2 years to do whatever it is that you wanted with the commission, and you were okay with them not meeting at all. And so I think now to sit here and say, we're going to do this now, because you feel, I don't know, some public pressure, I just want to register my objection that I think we have an investigation that's moving forward in terms of identifying who will do it. And I think we should see what the results of that investigation are before we proceed in a way. I mean, I feel like this action, moving forward in this way, disregards everything that why do the investigation, really?
I don't know why Anthony Mastrangelo's actions should prevent the town from having
I did not mention his name, and I have no issue with him. That's not what I'm talking about. And if I'm not clear, this has nothing to do with him. This has to do with Paula and the town's response. It has nothing to do with the defendant in that matter at all. And so the town's response is actually, the central issue here. It's the core issue. The town's response is in question. And now we're saying the town's going to go ahead and do whatever it wants. I object to that. And if I can clarify that my comments have nothing to do with Anthony Mastrangelo, I don't know how else I can do it. But what I've said tonight has nothing to do with him. I don't know if I can be more clear.
Right. I'm free on the 19th.
Okay. Can I have a motion to set?
Let's put Gina Chester down there.
What time? Is 6:30 okay?
Yeah.
Okay. All right. So a motion for a special. I mean, we won't be posted until like the day before. So I mean, if we get any other clarification, we can certainly make sure that's available.
And can you send all the responses?
Yeah, then absolutely.
And the ones you've received, and then send in the other ones. We'll so we have time to review them ahead of time.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. So, motion?
So moved.
Second?
No.
Aye. Second? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Mm-hmm. That's one day. Yeah. All right. The Park and Rec director's job description, I think that needs to be reviewed in order to put together an actual advertisement for a director. But I think, Gina, to go with your mindset a little bit, I think we said we were going to hold off on that a little bit to see what the internal review came up with.
Unless we're going to completely eliminate parks and recreation as an activity that the town does, you're going to have a park and rec director. There was a park and rec director before there was ever before school, after school.
Mm-hmm.
We held off before because we hadn't read the description, and right. It was some.
Which I think was dated 2005.
Yeah, I reviewed it. I don't know if you guys had a chance. There was, basically, it's the job description seemed to be, there was just a few things that. There was one that went into requirements. It was probably because the person preparing it just was interviewing the person already in the position and then wrote down things. So it says you, like under requirements, it has the service bus endorsement on driver's license. Mm-hmm. I don't know if that's really a job requirement or maybe a preference. And the other thing is under requirements, it said you have to use a certain kind of software, which I don't think we're using anymore. And then again, I don't know if you want to make it a requirement that they have used that software, because I'm assuming people can learn new software. So that would, again, go under preferences. But other than that, I didn't see a lot of things that really needed to be. Usually you don't try to put really specific things into job descriptions.
Okay. So there's really no.
But you want to put that on the agenda for the 19th also?
We could do that. Sure. So it'll be the commission and the job description.
Not description.
I just have to say that I think that it's really unfortunate to even be thinking about posting a job. And
well, we don't necessarily have to post it. We just at least can review the job description and make sure that it's kind of up to date. 2005 is a while ago.
So is the Board of Selectmen going to be reviewing other job descriptions? Or just this one?
Well, we thought we'd review it before we posted it.
But we're not going to provide it right away. Are we going to be reviewing other job descriptions? I don't see the point of reviewing this job description.
To post the position.
Yeah, I don't see why we would post the position.
I think we should.
Well, we do. I think it's sort of a
we're not going to really post it.
And I don't know if people here or on the Zoom were listened in on the Board of Finance meeting, which I would encourage you to do. One person mentioned that from 2:15 to 4 o'clock, there may not be an adult in the room when these kids were in the town program. And I just think that, you know, that it's possible that has been resolved. What I was alarmed about is that nobody in the meeting had any answers to this question, and that it's okay to be uncertain over whether or not an adult is going to be in the room for almost 2 hours when there's children being cared for in this town. And I just am amazed and shocked at the comfort of with this liability that everyone seems to have. It's really shocking to me.
Why wouldn't you want to hire somebody who has experience, who worked in another town and who would know how to do things properly?
Because, first of all, we need new leadership. Second of all, I think hiring someone under these circumstances is unfair. Third of all, I think that you know, talking about hiring someone when the program is a mess, from where I stand, you know, and I don't know, maybe people here are okay with leaving their kids small children in a room in a program with no adults. I don't know. Because nobody in that meeting had an answer to that, and I was alarmed.
If you have problems, you get rid of the employees.
No.
And
sexually assaulting children, and then you have no adult in the room, you close the program, is what you do. And I'm not saying, I know there are families, 40 families or whatever, who really need the care, and what I'm asking is, has the town done anything at all in terms of looking for other options? I'm glad the school is looking for an option. The town has resources. The town is paying our attorneys a hell of a lot more money this year than we thought we would have to pay, right? Has the town thought about offering these families, a bus ride to the JCC? Has the town reached out to Surreybrook? Has the town reached out to any other program? Has the town thought about why it may be important to have certified people watching the town's children? Has anyone thought about that? Has there been any movement in terms of any planning and looking to do something for the families of this town who need childcare? I don't think so, but I would love to hear an answer. And you know, just to say we're going to operate in crisis mode and just say we'll find someone who's going to accept the job like this at a moment like this, no, I don't think it's fair. And I think that the families in town with children in the program deserve more than what they've gotten. And I think, again, I'm looking for an answer as to why it's okay and why everyone was silent when it was reported that no adult would be in the room, or that there was a strong possibility that there would be no adult in the room. Why is that okay with the adults in the room now? Why is that okay?
I don't know why you have to answer. That question has nothing to do with, you don't have to say I'm okay with whatever you just said.
No, I meant the people at that meeting. No one said a word. It was mentioned, and everyone just sat there, and no one had an answer to this.
But this is, you mentioned, I agree, new leadership. So no one is going to fix these problems right now. There's no park and rec director. The assistant director has been on leave for over a month. There's no park and rec commission. Their terms all expired, and they're not meeting. So that's why I'm trying to get people in and rebuild it.
I don't think that's the answer. I think the answer is that we need a reboot. The town needs to do something for these families. And I'd like the town attorneys to tell us whether or not there's a benefit in terms of liability of shutting this program down. And I would like the answer to that question.
I'm happy to look into any.
No. Tell me right now. You've thought about this before. We've talked about this before. I want an answer.
Questions like that. I just thought I'm happy to look into it and provide you with a response.
I don't need a memo.
Gina, I'm not talking about the before squash. I'm talking about all the other things that Park and Rec does. Basketball and soccer and dance and
art. I'm talking about the children's program, but I do think that the whole program is a mess. And I think the liability that we have as a town is unacceptable. I think the town should do more for families that have children, and they easily could do that. Okay.
Nick is here, and I'd like some clarification.
I think that
if you want to get your answers,
I'm not finished. No, I don't need answers from Nick. What I'm talking about is a meeting. I heard what was said, and there was silence when the issue came up about whether or not an adult would be in the room. Like I said in my comments, it's possible that that issue has been resolved. But there was a moment at the meeting where nobody knew, and everyone was okay with it. Okay. And I just want to say, Ben, this is the reason why a lot of people perceive you as being Paul's attorney instead of the town attorney, okay? Mm-hmm. Because
this is not really talking about
because in order for me to properly respond, I need to understand the facts. You made a lot of statements, none of which are supported by the facts, as I understand it.
Okay.
If you'd like to get the facts, and I can understand the facts, I'm happy to look into any matter that you want. You've asked for questions of liability based on your speculation of events.
Okay, my speculation.
Because you said there's going to be no adult present for a period of time.
That wasn't my question. My question is not to ask you if there's liability if there's no adult in the relationship. The answer is obvious. That wasn't my question.
Is there more liability keeping it open?
No.
Then what's your question?
We've talked about actually, maybe we wasn't there that day. My question is, in general, given what has happened since December 2022, is it a benefit to the town in terms of liability to shut the program down right now? Or for there to be a transition for the town to do something for these families that they deserve that? And if, yes or no, is there a benefit in terms of liability? I'm not talking about whether or not an adult is in the room. That is an obvious question that everybody here knows the answer to.
Have not provided enough facts to provide an intelligent response.
Okay, that's it. I don't have any more questions about this. I think it's obvious and everybody knows. It's obvious. Okay. And I think you've been at enough meetings that you know what I'm asking. So, I mean, that this is why. And, you know, I have to point it out where I see it, and I regret the times where I remain silent on these issues. I really do. And so I would just have a request for the town to look at doing something for these families. And I don't know, someone told me it was 40-ish families, and providing them with either a bus in JCC or, you know, having a time period where the town pays for the additional fee, whatever it would be, and so that there would be some bridge until the school program could be open.
Moving along. Number 12, discussion and possible action on potential funding for management review consultant as recommended by the town attorney. And this is for all departments. This is not just for Park and Rec. This is across the board for all departments to look at how they're running, if they're doing right, if there's deficiencies, and that kind of thing. So,
it's interesting how we have money for all of this other stuff, but nobody wants to do anything for these families that need childcare.
I know Jen Kapasowicz had handed something out at a previous meeting, in advance of a previous meeting, about a proposal to do something with management study of just the Park and Rec department, but I haven't seen anything about a proposal or scope of work for all departments. And it's certainly, you know, it's come up with the Park and Rec director that there was the town hired somebody about 20 years ago to go through all the job descriptions and update them, and probably they should be looked at, but I don't think that's exactly an emergency.
I want to know why, if you've been in office for about 6 years, why hasn't this been done before? Why hasn't the town attorney worked with you, and why haven't you looked at the policies in each department in town? Is 6 years not enough time?
When I came into office, there were a couple of departments that blatantly needed a look, and that was finance, and that was the building department. And I took a look at those, and we made adjustments that we needed to make. My first 2.5 months in office,
I got rid of three top positions because they needed to be doing a better job of, they weren't doing their job, let's put it that way. So I made changes and to move things forward and to get things done. So,
you know, management studies, I work for companies and have them, usually they're looking for efficiencies and I can hire fewer people. And, the impression I get is that's not what the town is looking for. It's very unusual to pay a consultant for a very small town staff. I mean, I could certainly see updating the, having somebody take a look at the job descriptions, and I think at the time they were looking at the compensation, because there was a lot of complaints about, you know, whether people were being fairly compensated. But again, I don't see that as an emergency that's coming out of the substantial matter. I don't know what kind of dollar amount we're talking about.
I mean, that's certainly something that we could put on hold right now until the other interview and the other independent review is done. And that's thoughts.
Yeah, and I we want to see a scope of work and what the cost is. Is something has to go to a town meeting or be incorporated into a budget?
Well, we can certainly put that on hold.
What are your thoughts, Tina?
I mean, I like I said the last time that we were asked to review someone's resume, that was really it was a resume that didn't list what the credentials were, so it was difficult to even really gauge what the person's experience was. So my position would be to not proceed with the book. That's fine.
Yeah, and there was that individual's resume. I think he had worked for several towns, but mostly Newington. He had been the town manager there. Mm-hmm. And then there was another one that was sent to us, somebody who had retired from Meriden. And the problem is Newington has about 30,000 people and Meriden's about 60,000. So I have a feeling they're going to come in and go, oh, wow, there's a lot fewer people here than I'm used to. I mean, if that's all they're going to do is just say we need a lot more bodies, that's probably not going to go over too well.
That's true. But we can certainly hold on this.
It's something that should be pursued in the normal course, not in a rush.
Can hold it. Number 13, item 13 is a discussion possible action potential funding for legal matters beyond the scope of the retainer, and that's the Mastrangelo matter, basically.
There's no action for this body on that at this time.
It goes to the Board of
Finance.
Well, we could inform people that are here what this agenda item really means, right?
Is it number 13?
Oh, sorry. I thought I was loud.
You are.
I don't even know if they have this.
Yes.
The light on?
We're just too far away from it, sorry. I know in the Board of Finance minutes from August 13th, there was a Chairman Huxley will approach the Board of Selectmen at their next regular meeting regarding the $75,000 request, which would require a town meeting.
The way that it's listed on the agenda, then I believe if there's going to be a referral to a special town meeting, then it would be to consider an act on referring to a special town meeting the recommendation of the Board of Finance related to.
Okay.
So the way it was listed,
through you. Okay. So this is basically to at the next time we have a town meeting is to refer this, but they have referred it to us to approve it to go to the town meeting.
Correct.
Got it.
So, if you don't have a special town meeting scheduled, which I'm going to do, you might want to just postpone this and list it properly on the agenda.
Correct.
So that it would be properly posted.
Okay. Okay, so we will move it to October with the proper posting. Okay.
So people here might not be aware that the town attorneys are seeking, I think, based on the Board of Finance meeting I was in under the Zoom, seeking $75,000 for their legal work and continuing to represent the town.
Well, just to be clear, we're not seeking a stated sum. We're, because there are a number of matters that fall outside the scope of the retainer that we wanted to inform both the Board of Selectmen and the Board of Finance about, related to a number of freedom of information complaints that were filed related to a number of matters related to Mastrangelo that we have been engaged in since July. And we wanted to get ahead of the legal expense rather than behind it. So we wanted to keep both this body and the Board of Finance informed. That's it.
$75,000 is an estimate.
What I informed the Board of Finance is that I would keep the chair of the Board of Finance informed on what I was doing, and that I would send a copy of the monthly invoices to her attention so she could again be informed on everything that is going on with respect to the Mastrangelo matter.
Thank you. Was there anything related to his access to town property?
Expansion of the PO. When he, and I don't have the date in front of me, when it's next on the court calendar is when I intend to appear before the court.
Isn't that this week?
Again.
Okay.
It's on right tomorrow. So
I knew it was coming up this week, but.
Okay, a grant update. As far as ARPA is concerned, most projects have been identified and the spending is. Most projects are complete or being completed, so we can wrap up as much of the spending as possible by December 31st of this year so that the money does not get clawed back. STEEP, we are waiting for approval from the state for our bid documents to go out. Because of the entity that has been assigned the project with the state, everything must be approved by them prior to going out to bid for the expansion of the Public Works Garage. The two Cabrera grants are being wrapped up and final paperwork is being submitted to the state to close those out. We have spent just about the entirety of the $700,000 on various things with the town in windows and expansion of this room to include the air conditioning. The DeLauro grant of $1 million is through HUD. Every time we make a change order on the grant, we need to resubmit the entire package to HUD for reapproval. That is what is slowing down the reimbursement process on the grant. We authorized a $250,000 working capital for this, for the reimbursement, and we are close to that $250,000 in spent money. As soon as that money is reimbursed through the grant, we will move forward with the next phase of the project to continue the work. Human Services Department has received approximately $15,000 in leftover COVID money that the director will be using for some new programs and enhanced programs for the senior center. And The only other item going on is there, we were able to submit the expansion of the lodge to turn it into a community shelter, emergency shelter, and that project is still floating through the approval process. We have not received a yes and we have not received a no. We're in a status quo. The application has been submitted, but we are waiting for approval before. We do not know if that will be approved or not, but we have requested that through FEMA since it would be considered an emergency shelter. That's it.
Did you say, did you give an update on the Round Hill Road project? Because I may have missed it.
I did not. There is nothing to report on Round Hill Road at this time.
Okay.
So that's why I skipped over.
Okay.
When is the trip grant due, or has it been submitted?
We do not have any information yet on this year's trip grant.
Yeah.
Because they were looking to rewrite the program, the guidelines for the program.
Yeah. So we have yet to hear anything back from them. Once we do, we will move forward with it. So, okay. May I have a motion to go into exec? Oh, I need an amendment. Before we do that, I need an amendment to the agenda to add a new item 16 and make adjournment 17, because we actually need to have discussion and possible action on the executive session item. I forgot to include that on the original agenda. So may I have a motion to add that item so that we can discuss and act on the executive session? Second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay, now, Paula, I'd like to make a motion in connection with what I was saying before. I just would like to make a motion to have the town look at what it would cost and to have the kids, Park and Rec kids, bused to the JCC or some other similar program, and to just do that research to see if that is an available option, with the goal of closing the Park and Rec child care program until we get some answers that we're seeking in terms of the investigation.
I'm not going to second that.
I'll second it. I thought it was a good idea with getting information.
Not to disrupt parents and families that have already got this program.
All Gina was asking to find out costs.
I could certainly reach out and find out something like that, but I'm not.
Can JCC handle the number of kids? What would be the cost to provide transportation? It's just a request for looking into it.
Yes, I mean, I can do that without.
Did you hear the motion? I mean, it's really irritating when I make a motion and you respond to some other motion that you think you've heard. Maybe I should go further, but for today, my motion is information, gathering information.
Yes, I can gather information, but
I mean, that's it. That's the motion for today. That's it.
Right. We can't make decisions without information.
Right.
It's just like at a previous meeting, we asked you to consult with the superintendent.
And I did the next day. Right. So and I did the next day.
The same thing, but this time looking at JCC plus bus from to BCS.
And having the town pay the difference.
Yeah, with the cost.
Right.
So the town would subsidize.
Mm-hmm. Right, just like the town is subsidizing the current program.
Explain.
I was at the on the Zoom with the Board of Finance, and I heard that the town had to provide $100,000 to the Park and Rec program.
That was prior fiscal years, not the way the program is set up for this fiscal.
So what year did that happen? I mean prior, meaning 2003?
No, I mean up to June 30th of 2024. For fiscal year 25, the fees were set up for net neutral.
Okay, so it is fairly recent that the town was subsidizing the program.
Just so you made a motion, something like that. I don't know if there's one more.
We can't hear you.
I think you want to make a motion to amend the agenda.
I mean, it was in connection with what we were talking about with Park and Rec already. So it was already part of the discussion. The number 9. So my motion is in connection with item 9. Thank you.
Okay, second.
Yeah,
second. Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Okay, we will look into the JCC.
The purposes of executive session. The purpose of executive session, just to make sure that the record reflects you inviting in, which would include myself, Attorney Cruz, Attorney Weaver, and the tax assessor. The tax assessor and Attorney Weaver will be joining this session.
No, it's a tax assessor.
That's Betsy Cruz.
And should be at Zoom?
Yeah.
Is anyone else invited? Do we need Board of Finance Chair and just the assessor at this point?
Yes.
Okay. All right, can I have a motion to go into executive session with sole attorneys and the assessor? A second, please.
A second.
All in favor? I'm going to pause the recording, and it is.
Recording stopped. Recording in progress.
Thank you, everyone, for your patience. This shouldn't take too long. We amended the agenda to add an item prior to us going into executive session, and that is a discussion and possible action on settlement of a tax appeal, and that is regarding the Connecticut Water Company versus Town of Bethany. I will let you see this after. I'm going to spiel off the docket number. NNH-CV-24-614-3462-S. This was regarding a case with the Connecticut Water Authority's dam and their revow assessment. And so they made an appeal, and we are approving. Let me find that paragraph. Reducing the tax liability, and Vin, correct me if I'm wrong, but it's $28,757.
What you're really doing is agreeing to the recommendation of the tax assessor to reduce the assessment
by the 20.
By I believe it was 15%.
15%.
Right.
Yep. Okay.
Because it's a tax appeal related to the assessment on the property. So it's really not a reduction of tax. That's the consequence. It's a reduction of the assessment.
Okay. Can I get a motion to approve?
So moved.
Second?
Second.
Any other comments or questions? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Okay. That is it. And then motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
We are adjourned at 8:23. Thank you, everyone, and have a wonderful rest of your evening.
Recording stopped.